Praise the Lord, everybody. Praise the Lord, everybody. It's good to be in the house of the Lord, isn't it? We come and praise the Lord. You have your praise on. We clap our hands. We're going to raise our hands. We're going to magnify the Lord. Hallelujah. Let's join together. Because of who you are, I give your breath. Because
believers in the house today. You will do great things. Woo! He's a great God. Why not?
Oh, he is not from hell. You conquer the grave. You free every captive. Every chain. Oh, God. You have done great things. We dance in your freedom. Awake in the mind. Oh, Jesus.
He's unshakable. Jesus.
Dancing your presence, dancing your presence. blessed be thy name, O Lord Jesus.
Thank you, Lord.
Praise God.
Thank you, Lord.
Praise you.
The church said, praise the Lord. Amen. Can you feel God's beautiful presence in this place? Thank you, God, for coming to meet with us, Lord. The unseen guest, the most honored guest. Amen. Hallelujah. You may be seated. God bless you. And at this time, we're going to dismiss our young people to their classes. And you know what to do. God bless our teachers, every faithful teacher we have. And God bless our parents to get a little break. Amen. They love the kids, but I tell you what, a little bit of me time, well, it would be we time because it's you and God. We get to open up his word today. Somebody say, praise the Lord. Are you with Pastor this morning? Somebody say, praise the Lord.
Praise the Lord.
Amen. And we're so happy to have each one of you in the house of the Lord. Amen. You are my joy in the Lord. Amen. My wife and I love this church body. And I'll tell you what, absence does make the heart grow fonder. I'll tell you what, a little time away and you come back and you're just so happy to see everybody. Amen. God bless these beautiful children. Amen. I'd like you in your Bibles to turn to 1 Thessalonians chapter 5. And for a few moments this morning, I want to talk to you about the times and seasons. The times and the seasons. Verse 1 of chapter 5 of 1 Thessalonians, if you found it, you can say amen. All right. But of the times and seasons, brethren, ye have no need that I write unto you. For yourselves know perfectly, amen, that the day of the Lord so cometh as a thief in the night. For when they shall say peace and safety, what are we hearing about today? Safety. Safety. Be safe. This is for your safety. Amen. Now, the scripture is not making a judgment on our particular situation. It's giving us a description of the age or the season in which Jesus is going to come back. It's going to be a time when people are very concerned about their safety. Oh, I wish that people were as concerned about their eternal salvation as they are about their physical well-being. But I'll tell you what, today people are in danger with their mental health, their physical health, their financial health. These situations, this time and season that we have found ourselves in, affects everything about everybody all the way around the world. And I'll tell you what, you need to get into the Word of God more than the news media. Amen? Because you don't want to feed yourself a steady diet of this overwhelming fear that a lot of people are panicking. Even I've seen some good people that were Christians that were affected. So I want to talk to you for just a little bit about times and seasons. Let's pray. Father, thank you for your word, and thank you for talking to Pastor and giving me a message from the throne. Let it be burned into our hearts and minds. Let us remember it, and let it help us, Lord, throughout this week and the months to follow. In Jesus' name, everybody said amen. Amen. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. So I want to talk to you a little bit about seasons. And there is a passage in Ecclesiastes chapter 3. And I know Sue is very quick on the draw there to find things. We'll give her just a second to find it. Ecclesiastes chapter 3. And this is a chapter that has helped me immensely as I've been in different seasons of my life to be able to accept some things. To everything, everybody say everything.
Everything.
There is a season. And a time to every purpose under the heaven. A time to be born and a time to die. Let me just stop there and say, some people think they can live foolishly and say, well, when my time comes, I'll go. But if you are careening down the road and that road's icy and the conditions aren't good and you're going 160 kilometers an hour, don't think that God's going to wait and take you at your time. You're probably going to take your own life. Amen? Jesus said, thou shalt not tempt the Lord thy God. But I believe that when we live reasonable, sensible lives of faith and we live a good life and love the Lord and love our neighbors, that God is going to give us the time that he has promised. There is an appointed time. And the Bible says, children, obey your parents, honor your mother and father,
For if you do so, that your days may be long upon the face of the earth. In other words, if somebody is rebellious, God can shorten their days. Amen? How many know that when we are in submission to authority in our lives, and that's, there's all kinds of authorities. There's judges and there's police officers, and some people hate the police. I'm thankful for the police. Amen. I'm thankful tonight, this morning rather, and tonight when I go home, I still will lock my doors. But I'm thankful that we live in a country where there is some law and order.
Right.
Amen. I know that there's a real backlash against any and all authority today, and people want to speak out against the police force. Do you believe, Brother Gallon, that police can be wrong? Yeah, I believe that in a good barrel of apples, there could be a bad apple. Yeah, you could go and get, you know, a bunch of fruit, put it together, and one little bit of fruit starts to go bad. And what does it do? But it contaminates the whole lot. So what do? You've got to take that bad fruit out and keep it separated from the good fruit. And I believe that within all areas where there is authority, there will be an abuse of power in certain situations. And we pray that God will give us wisdom and that God will help our leaders to be able to govern and to direct the affairs so that we can be blessed with physical health, financial well-being, and just peace and harmony. Amen?
Amen?
Hallelujah. How many know that every mom and dad's got some rules? Got any rules in your home, moms and dads? I bet you do. Amen. And I bet the kids know when they cross the line, don't they? And hopefully they show you respect if they do and you correct them. Because I'll tell you what, we are living in a day where rebellion is rampant. There is a spirit and an attitude in our day that says, don't you tell me what to do. And let me tell you something, if you've got that attitude in your heart, if you've got, now it looks like I'm pointing at my wife here. She's the most submissive person here. But if you've got that attitude, if something rises up within you when you're asked to do something, then ask yourself, is the problem with the authority or is the problem with the response to the authority? Amen. I believe that moms and dads love their kids. I believe that moms and dads see further down the road. Amen. I believe that pastors see further down the road. If I can't see further down the road, then you better find a church where you've got a pastor that can see further down the road. Amen. I give you permission to go pastor hunting. Amen. But I tell you something, I pray that you won't get a pastor that will be up at 4 o'clock in the morning like I was this morning praying for your souls. You won't get, there's not a lot, and I'm not bragging, I'm just telling you something. I love you, and I love you enough. I'm going to tell you the truth. I'm going to preach to you, and I'm going to tell you that there's a time and a season for everything. There's a time to be born. There's a time to die. There's a time to plant, and there's a time to pluck up that which is planted. Now, I've been working in the garden a little bit lately, now that I'm feeling better. Somebody asked me the other day, how are you feeling? I said, I'm feeling so good. If I felt any better, there'd be two of me. I'm feeling so good. But I get winded easily, and I have to kind of conserve my energy. But the get up and go has not got up and went. It's still in there. Just sometimes the body can't keep up with my spirit. But I've been working in the garden and pulling out some things and tossing it into the composter. And I discovered all kinds of tomatoes. I discovered some cucumbers I had missed. And I got some carrots to dig up. And hopefully the frost wasn't too bad last night. I get home and there'll be some more tomatoes, but I just love the season of harvest. How many of you love the fall? Don't you think that the fall is one of the most beautiful times of the year? Especially if you get to get out on the road with your job and you just, take in the glory of God. The Bible says the heavens declare the glory of God and all creation, his handiwork. What an unbelievable artist God is. And so this season is a beautiful season. How many of you love spring the best? Spring is your favorite season, all right? And I know why you do, because you want to get out digging in the dirt, right? How many of you like summer the best? You like to get out and get some sun. And how many of you like fall? How many of you fall? Well, I love fall. I got to say, it's a good time of year. I was born in the fall. I was born again in the fall. I got the Holy Ghost in October. Hallelujah. I believe it was around October, November. But every time I get into the season, it reminds me the atmosphere outside and the weather and the temperatures and just the scents all around remind me of that time that I got the Holy Ghost. And I love the fall because I love the leaves. And I guess I have to say probably it's one of my favorite seasons. And the others are like spring and summer are very, very close seconds and thirds for sure. And winter, well, I like snow for Christmas. And God, you can melt it all the way in January. I'm really not, do you want to make a snowman? Yeah. Maybe if I had a little granddaughter. I just got a grandson, and we're going to be doing the trains and the blocks and all that kind of fun stuff. But I do like winter, and I love when there's snow on Christmas. That makes me really happy to have some snow. And I think it makes everything look fresh and clean. But every season is special, and every season is necessary. And I just want to talk a little bit about the different seasons. Springtime, of course, is the season for planting. It's the season for sowing. And you know something? Some of you are very interested in winning the lost. Your burden, your passion, what you live for is to help somebody else to come to Jesus Christ. God bless you for your burden. God bless you for your witness. And sometimes we sow seeds and we don't even see where we're accomplishing anything. Let me tell you something. Just submit to God, because I believe that there's something very powerful that happens when we sow and we submit. Amen? How many know that a pastor could get up and preach off the same notes and preach the same words to you and raise my voice at all the right times? But if my heart's not submitted to God, there's no power. You're not going to be touched. You're not going to be impacted. You're not going to be changed. Amen? So you can do all the right things, but do it with the right spirit and attitude. And I'll tell you what, for me, that's like a full-time job sometimes. Amen? I will have to work hard. But springtime is a season for planting. When you have opportunities to minister, to encourage, take those opportunities. You know something that happened to me when you were all praying for Pastor to be healed physically? Is God did something in my heart. There's some hurts from way, way back in my past that caused some walls to be put up. Well, I had trouble trusting. I had trouble really trusting people. And sometimes people in authority. And when God touched me, something happened in my mind and in my heart. I could feel a difference. And you know something? How many know that this pastor loves his wife? You know that, don't you? People have commented on it before. I adore my wife. Amen. I think she's the prettiest thing could walk into any room. But she's beautiful on the inside. She has a beautiful spirit, and she cares for people's feelings. And when people share something in confidence, she keeps it. She'll keep that. You don't have to worry. And the Bible says that a man that has a good wife, his heart can safely trust it. And I'm so grateful for my wife. And I think I treat her pretty good. I'm always encouraging. Well, go ahead and buy it. You know, oh no. And my wife is the type, honestly, that she's not going to pay $40 for a dress. God bless you if you do. That's all right. But my wife is so economical. She hits the bargain stores. She likes Repeat Boutique over here. And Frenchie's, she's a thrifter. I mean, she's a thrifting machine. She can find brand new clothes. She can find like a $100 dress and pay $5 for it. And do I feel bad? Think, well, I'm not a very good provider. I just admire her. What she could stretch a dollar, well, back when a dollar was a dollar bill, around this church three times. She just has an awesome gift. And I think I've treated her pretty good. She stayed with me 32 years. It's not been that bad. You know, she could have left me after 7 years of tribulation, but she didn't. But you know something? Something happened to me in my heart. A lot of the wonderful thoughts that I would have about her through the day, I just started expressing them. And I shocked her because I became so affirming. And she said to me, she said, "You're not dying, are you, Bill?" And it's not like, you know, I never complimented her. I'd always tell her, that looks nice on you. But something happened. And I found, I know some of you, maybe I've reached out to, and some of you I haven't got to yet. But I found an outpouring of love out of my heart, because God knocked some walls down. There was a healing that took place when you all prayed for me that went beyond my physical body to my mind and my spirit. And maybe you grew up in a home where you didn't, maybe you felt like a bother. Maybe you grew up in a home where there's some scars. Maybe your daddy was an alcoholic, or maybe your mom was a drug addict, or maybe you lost one of your parents when you were young, or maybe you just always felt rejected. Maybe you grew up and you felt like you were compared to your siblings and not in a favorable way. And there's a need for heart surgery in your life. And you say, oh God, I wish I could be more loving. Oh God, I just wish these walls could come down. Oh God, I just wish you would heal me. Let me tell you something. There's healing in this room today. And God healed me, and God spoke to me. He said, I have healed you so that I can heal the congregation. Because there's a wave of supernatural power that's going to heal broken hearts, going to heal emotions, going to heal minds. Amen. I'm going to heal the church because God says everybody that comes through those doors needing salvation is going to need mental and emotional and spiritual healing and many of the physical healings. And God has told me that he's going to begin to work in this place. And he also physical healings and great miracles are going to take place in the bodies for the glory of God. And that people will know that God is real and that his power is in this place. Can you say amen? I'm beginning to pray already for healing because I believe it's this time, I believe it's a season that God makes you completely 100% whole on the inside and the outside. So much so that people walk up to you and say, what has happened to you? You are a different person. Your face lights up the room and you can say, God touched me and supernaturally healed me. And I can tell you something, the healing of the mind is greater than the healing of the body. Hallelujah. And the healing of the emotions is greater than the healing of the body. But the healing of the spirit, when God saves you, when God delivers you from the power of sin, when God takes away those old cravings for things that are self-destructive, when God changes you and you don't want the things you used to want, and you begin to want the things that God would want for you, that is the greatest healing, is to be born of the water and born of the spirit. And you can walk in victory. God has a level for you to live on that is far superior to what you're experiencing right now. And I believe with all my heart that this church, Cornerstone Tabernacle, is entering into a season and a time where God is going to take us above and beyond. You expect miracles? Oh, yes, I certainly do, congregation. I'm expecting an outpouring of the Holy Ghost like we have never seen in 5 years. I believe that God's going to do above and beyond all that we can ask or think. And it's springtime. It's time, the Bible says, to plow the fallow ground. That means the fields that are at potential but have been lying dormant for years. Plow up the fallow ground. Prepare and begin to sow the seed. This month I declare a month of prayer and fasting. I believe that God's going to kickstart us into soul winning endeavors. I believe that souls are going to come into this church and be born again. I believe that lives are going to be transformed. I believe that marriages are going to be put together. Homes are going to be mended. I believe that God's going to change complete neighborhoods in our town. I believe it because God has spoken to me. The other day, I was lying there on the couch, semi-coma. You know, I move around quite a bit. I move quick. I found out one time when I got vertigo years ago, just how fast I move. I thought that was normal because any slight movement, but anytime I want to do something, I was so used to my head jerking around and my body would respond fairly quickly if I need to do something. And I didn't realize until I got vertigo just how fast that moved. And then everything had to go into slow-mo for a while. Way down in slow motion. Hallelujah. Oh, just lift your hand and love the Lord for a moment. Thank you, God. You're so good. I just worship you. I praise you. Amen. So we're going to enter into a time of soul winning and Sunday school drive and just whatever we can to get Bible studies going. And there are Bible studies being taught in this church. If you don't have a Bible study, just see us, see James or Michelle, and they'll set you up with a Bible study. I'd love to teach a Bible study to anybody here. If you'd like one, just let me know. We can do it in your home or we can do it online if the season isn't right for you with health and everything. But before we launch an outreach like that, we want to launch prayer ministry. I'm asking you this month of October, this is October the 3rd, I'm asking you to spend extra time in prayer and fasting. Why, Pastor? Because it's springtime. Oh, I know it's fall, but it's time to sow. We need to sow prayer into God's kingdom. Because I believe if we want a great outpouring of God's power, there better be a great outpouring of prayer. If we want a great outpouring of revival, then there ought to be a great outpouring of sacrifice and dedication. Amen? Because I'll tell you what, the fire that falls on the altar has got to consume something. The altar is going to remain, but the sacrifice, the greater the sacrifice you and I put on the altar, the more we sacrifice our will, and the more we sacrifice of our time, and the more we sacrifice for God's kingdom, the more there is for God to consume by his fire. The fire will not outdo the sacrifice. Amen. It is a time for sacrifice. It is a time for sowing. Hallelujah. And some of you said you liked summer the best. My wife did. Summer is the season for weeding and maintenance. You've got a garden. You know you can't just plant it and leave it. How many know? You've got to really put some time into it. And that's what makes a garden, vegetable garden or flower garden, so beautiful. It's the fact that somebody takes the time to weed. You say, well, God's blessed me. God's touched me. I'm going to make it all the way. You know what? You still got to weed. You still got to weed. Every once in a while, I got to pull an attitude. Every once in a while, I got to apologize. If you're too big to apologize, you're just a really small person. Amen? If you offend somebody two, three times, apologize two, three times. Get used to it. It's called repentance. Amen? And then practice it with God as well. Amen. I want to keep the spirit of repentance alive in my life. It's going to be summertime pretty soon. And while all the wonderful good things burst out of the ground, also the weeds start to grow. And how many know the weeds will overtake the good? You don't have to plant weed seeds. You don't have to fertilize weeds. You don't have to cultivate. You don't have to talk to those plants. Those plants will, you can argue with them, they'll still grow. Amen. And so it is with anything unspiritual. Sometimes we wonder, well, is my Holy Ghost not strong enough? Yeah, your Holy Ghost is strong enough. Do I maybe don't have the Holy Ghost? Oh, you got the Holy Ghost. The Holy Ghost just doesn't have you and I yet. We're a work in progress. Look at your neighbor and say, you're a work in progress. Or you just say, you're a real work of art. Praise the Lord. But God helps us during the summer to weed and do maintenance. Amen. And for those of you like me that love autumn, autumn is the time of harvest. But harvest will not be what it is if there isn't a time of sowing and a time of weeding. Amen. Everything good that God does, you've got to maintain. You say, well, God gave you this miracle. Amen. And you can get sick again too if you don't take care of your health. Amen. There might be something God wants you to do along with the miracle to maintain your health. How many know that you don't pour water and all kinds of crud into the gas tank of your vehicle? You put in the good stuff, right? Amen. Or if you're like me, you put in the cheap stuff. It burns up pretty fast. Amen. But you take care of that engine. If you don't take care of your engine, of your vehicle, and then, you know, you go to the shop and say, I don't know what's wrong with this Chevy. Maybe I'm crossing the line. I shouldn't. I don't know what's wrong with this Ford. I don't know what's wrong with this Dodge, but you never change the oil. You never ever replace the spark plugs. You never ever take it in and get something, you know, looked at because it doesn't sound right. How many know you've got to maintain that vehicle? If you want that vehicle to get from here to where you need to go, and you need to maintain your spiritual being if you want to get from here to where God wants you to go. And if you want to be powerful, if you want your engine to deliver some power, then you might need to put an engine treatment in it every once in a while. Amen? And so summertime is a time of maintaining, but autumn is the time when we get to enjoy the harvest. Isn't it so much fun? You guys love it. Do you like to go apple picking? Do you ever go apple picking? Look at that. Am I a prophet or what? Hallelujah. Wasn't it fun? You know, Ronnie, when you were little, you probably thought those trees were so tall. Have you noticed how they're getting shorter every year? Yeah. Yeah, we have to climb up a ladder. Now we can just, there's nothing any nicer than picking fresh apples, amen? Yeah. And going out in the garden and harvesting that squash. And I've got some carrots. I haven't had one this year. I don't know what's in the ground, but I'm kind of excited. She likes to eat stuff right out of the ground. Yeah, right out of the ground. You know, just wipe it off and whatever. Yeah, she grew up in the country. Yeah, amen. And I remember that, or hosing it off and just, you know, even breaking off a stick of rhubarb. Harvest is exciting. We harvest in the church because we have planted and we have maintained. And I want to tell you something. It's so important that we sow the seeds of love. It's very important that we always be in the frame of mind of love, because sometimes we sow a seed and that'll be an eternal seed and we may turn somebody off from the gospel. Can I be honest with you? I was in the store the other day and I was a little frustrated because I had bought something at one store in Fredericton, which closed, and I had to go all the way to Oromocto, which was 25 minutes to go and get. And it was under warranty, and it was just a small little doodad for my computer. And I was frustrated because I didn't have any there, but that didn't bother me so much. They said, we've got, they're just in short supply. And they said, but we can, and I was nice and everything, but they said, we have one in St. John, and they will send it down here. I said, well, can you send it to me? Because I said, I've just spent like 25 minutes coming out. And it'll be like 50 minutes round trip. I really don't want to. Well, we can't really have it delivered to a home address. And then I started to get a little frustrated. And I said, well, do any of you live in Fredericton? Maybe you could bring it in. I could meet you somewhere, meet you at Tim Hortons or whatever. And I don't think it was probably so much what I put out, but it was what I felt inside that bothered me. Is that I was getting frustrated with these people that were trying to serve me and do the best they could in a circumstance where they didn't develop the policies. And it wasn't that I was raised my voice or was mean or anything, but I knew that my face was showing my attitude. And so I said to the girl, I said, I'm so sorry, I said, if I appear a little testy. I said, I haven't been feeling well, and sometimes when I'm starting to come around, I'm just a little bit on edge. And she said to me very kindly, she said, that usually happens to me right before I get sick. But anyway, I apologized. And you know something? They couldn't have done more for me. They bent over backwards. They were so nice. She even tried to get me a discount for something else that I was looking to pick up at the same time. What are you saying, Pastor? You're a failure? No, I'm not a failure. I'm just telling you that sometimes I get tired, like you get tired, and I get impatient, even with the people that I love so much. And sometimes I say things and I think, oh, I didn't say that the way I really should have. And I didn't really mean to hurt anybody. But let me tell you something. During this time of COVID, there's so many people getting hurt. Could we not be the most loving people on the face of the earth, at least here in St. George? Amen. Could we really pray that God would help us this month to grow spiritually? I want to tell you something. You will lose your patience, especially with your family and your loved ones. And don't beat yourself up if you do it. Just try to make it up to them. How many know that that makes a big difference? You can come alongside. You can do something for them. You say, I'm sorry. I know I wasn't. How many know that that'll make your relationship sweeter and dearer? Don't beat yourself up if you're not perfect. Pastor's not perfect. That's why I talk this way sometimes, is to let you know that I don't have it all together. But Jesus does. And he's on the inside. And if I could just let more of him out, oh, praise God. Would you lift your hands? Is that the way you feel today? God, help us just to let more of you in and to let more of you out, oh God. Help us, oh Lord. There's a season for God to bless, and there's a season for harvest. Autumn is the time of harvest. Well, what about winter? Winter, well, that's when all the leaves come off the trees, and that's when it's cold and arthritis bothers us. Well, you can look at it that way. You can look at it this way. Sometimes it's a nice time to have a rest. Because you don't really sow a lot in that season, and you don't have to maintain, and you don't have to harvest. You know what winter's for? When things are bleak and gray and dark, it's a time for enjoying your harvest. That's when you can bring those. Anybody make some preserves? Anybody do any preserves? What'd you make? You guys are a factory out there. Anybody made any salsa this year? Come on, saints. I need a saint that makes salsa. Anybody make salsa? Yeah. Hallelujah. Oh, hallelujah. I feel God in this place. Praise the Lord. How many of you like to pickle and preserves and do these things? And then you get to enjoy it in the winter. The labors in the other seasons. You know, you go out there and try to plant something in the wintertime. It ain't going to grow. There's no point in weeding. There's no point, because winter is a rest time. How many know that there are seasons in our lives spiritually when we just need to rest? For me, it was the last 3 weeks. Pastor needed to rest. And now I'm back. I'm stronger in the Lord. I've got more with God. You know, one of the things that God spoke to me, winter is a time of reset, right? It's a time of reset. It's the time of dormancy. But God spoke to me. He said, you're thinking about the Great Reset. They're pushing for 2030 to have the whole world under this new government. That's the goal. There's videos, there's information online. It's not a conspiracy, it's a fact. It's a fact, because they're talking about it. They're talking about it on the media. Amen. And I'm not talking Facebook, and I'm talking about the other media. It's out there. That's the goal, is to bring the whole world under. And they're calling it the Great Reset. And the other day, the Lord spoke to me. I was laying on the flat of my back, and I still not feeling really well. And God said, don't you worry one little bit about the Great Reset. He said, because I got a Great Reset that I'm working on right now. God says, I'm resetting my church to be like the book of Acts. I'm resetting the faith of my people. I'm resetting their focus so that things, little things don't bother them. little things that don't go their way, so that they can focus on all the good things and the blessings of God when life is shaking around about them. I am resetting my church. I'm bringing my church back to the book of Acts, power and glory. In fact, God told me, he said, I'm going to do in this latter-day church more than what was done in the early church. Don't you worry about their great reset. He said, it will not happen until I say it will happen. But I've got a great reset up my sleeve, and I'm resetting you. And I want to tell you something. God reset Pastor. I've been recalibrated. Amen. Hallelujah. I've had an alignment. Praise God. Hallelujah. I've had an oil change. I've got fresh oil. Hallelujah. I've got fresh power. Amen. I've got a new brake job. Amen. Sometimes I need to know when to stop and not say or not do something. Amen. You better have as good brakes as you do the gas. Amen. Don't be just led by your feelings and your passions. Make sure you have that self-control. Say, no, I'm not going to do that because it's not the right time, not the right season. Verse 3 says a time to kill and a time to heal. What? There's a time to kill? Yeah. How are you going to have that steak on your plate or that chicken? Killing is a part of life. Amen. It may not be a pleasant thing, but how many know that some things have to die? And we all will eventually die. But there's a time. I don't believe that God approves of murder, but I believe there are times when a country's got to stand up and defend itself against a hostile enemy. And there will be bloodshed and there will be lives lost. God is saying here that it's not always wrong. There is a time to kill and a time to heal. There's a time to break down and a time to build up. There's a time to weep. You know, it's not wrong to have a good cry. I wish I could. If you're a good crier here, I envy you. I wish I could. But it happens to me 2 or 3 times a year. And then when I lose it, I lose it. If I ever get crying behind the pulpit and I lose it, just pick me up and carry me out to my car. Because when I lose it, I lose it. And I never know when I'm going to be triggered. But I don't have that gift of some yet. But there is a time to weep and a time to laugh. There's a season. There's a time to mourn. And there's a time to dance. Amen. There's a time to cast away stones and a time to gather stones together. There's a time to embrace and a time to refrain from embracing. And the church said, amen. Is this the word of God?
Amen.
Sometimes the most loving thing we can do is not to shake a hand. I'm so thankful that I didn't hurt any of you. A time to get. You know, God's not against you enjoying life and getting something that you like. But there's also a time to lose. Sometimes through our losses in life, we are enriched and become greater people. Amen. We become compassionate. We become understanding. There's a time to lose. There's a time to keep. And there's a time to cast away. And oh, do I have a problem with that one? Because I think my first life was in the depression. Not that I had a first life. But I just say that jokingly because I'm like, well, I might need it 10 years down the road for 10 seconds. And I want to hold on to everything. And my wife loves organizing and cleaning out. She does. She loves throwing out things that we don't need. Well, what she does is she recycles, reduces, reuses, give them to somebody that can use them. Amen. She's constantly giving out boys' clothing and things and helping. Amen. It's wonderful. And we're not so proud that we can't receive, you know, if somebody had something that they didn't need. Amen. I think it's great to share in the church, isn't it? Amen. I get something from somebody I love, I'm proud to wear. Yeah. It says, verse 7, there's a time to rend, which means to tear, and a time to sow. There's a time to keep silence and a time to speak. Sometimes silence is golden, and sometimes silence is yellow. Some of you are looking at me like a deer in the headlight. How many know what a pastor is saying there? Raise your hand if you understand. I'll use my gift of interpretation. Well, if we say somebody's yellow belly, that means that they're but they don't have the backbone to speak their mind. And they're just, it's not that they don't think something, but they're just afraid to speak up. So sometimes silence is golden, sometimes it's a good thing. Sometimes silence is yellow, it's just somebody that's cowardly. That's what the scripture says. There's a time to love and a time to hate. How many know we need to love people but hate sin? Right? A time of war and a time of peace. But look at verse 11. I love this one. But every season, every time is from God. God's got something good. But he hath made everything beautiful in his time. He has made everything beautiful in his time. If you'll wait it out, if you can be patient with the Lord working in your life, God will bring true beauty out of your circumstances. Amen. Even out of your trials. But don't get impatient with God. Don't say, God, you should have done it yesterday. No, God will do it in his perfect timings. Can the church say amen?
Amen.
He has made everything beautiful in his time. You know, if we do things God's way and in God's order, it's wonderful. I'm glad that my wife and I were blessed to have four wonderful children. But I don't know how easy it would have been had, you know, we been young and foolish and she got pregnant at 14 or 15. It might not have been so beautiful. It might have been heart-wrenching. I believe that God can redeem any situation. And I believe that God is so loving and compassionate when we fail. But you know something? It was so much better for us to wait until we grew up, got married, and bring our children into a stable, loving home. Amen? And God can do that for every single person. God can do that. I don't even know your backgrounds. I have no idea your situation. But I'm just giving you an example of when you do it in God's time. You know, there's things I'd love to do for God, and I said, God, I'm just not sure if it's your time yet. Don't let me drag my feet, but don't let me run ahead of you, God, because you make everything beautiful in his time. Amen. It's so important that we just recognize the season. Now, the season, as this church that we are facing right now, is a season of harvest. It's, we're sowing this week, this whole month. I want us to be praying and fasting. Why? Because, well, for one thing, this is the month that the occult takes to fast and pray that every marriage of every minister and his family will be destroyed. They pray against churches. They pray for confusion. They pray for attack. They pray for disunity to happen within the church. And I want to tell you, no witch is going to get ahead of me when it comes to prayer and fasting. I am going to pray. I am going to fast. I am going to take this month, make it a month of submission and yielding to God. Why? Because we are preparing ourselves. Amen. We are sowing spiritually. And then we're going to be weeding. Don't be surprised if while you're praying and fasting extra, if the old devil raises his ugly head and you realize if something happens and you feel like you're out of sorts. Because I tell you something, when you begin to exercise warfare against him, he will battle you back. But don't you worry about him. Jesus is on the inside and he's already won the battle. Amen. Keep your eyes on Jesus and you will see the victory. But you can say, I've got the victory today. Lift your hand and say, I've got the victory today. This is a season of victory. But even when God allows you and I to go through a battle and a struggle, he's already planned the manifestation of the victory. You've already got the victory in Christ. Jesus is in your life. He is your victory. You say, well, I'd like to see it. Well, he will make everything beautiful in his time and in his season. You keep on sowing time in the Word of God. You keep on sowing time in faithful church attendance. You keep on sowing into relationships with people that are going in the same direction that you are spiritually. In other words, fellowship. And how many know you're going to get to your goal? If you'll read your Bible and you'll pray and you'll have the right kind of fellowship and we'll be in unity, how many know that God's going to reach down his hand and just going to multiply this whole thing? He already has. We have seen threefold multiplication in 5 years. What would happen if in the next couple of years we see another threefold? Hallelujah. How many know every time you push that snowball, It doesn't seem to be much at first, but then you start, there comes a point where it exponentially begins to pick up more snow because you've got more surface hitting the snow. And all of a sudden that snowball gets so big that you couldn't move it, only God could. Amen. That's the way it is with church growth. If we will grow spiritually, we'll grow mentally in our minds, in our knowledge. If we'll grow in the character of Jesus, in our nature, in the love of God, how many know that God's going to say, I can trust that people with a 20, 30-fold harvest? Amen. And those seeds that we're sowing that sometimes we don't feel like maybe are doing a whole lot, God will say, well, you're submitting to me. You're yielding to me. You got the right attitude and spirit. You got the right kind of faith. All right, you're ready. And God says, harvest. Boom. And harvest comes. Amen. Let's stand together. Hallelujah. There is a time. There is a season. I want to tell you something. This is a season of victory. This is a season of power. This is a season of going forward. It's not a season to complain. It's not a season to gripe. It's not a season to get down and discouraged. It's a season to believe God. It's a season to get into the promises of God. It's a season where we're believing for God to take us above and beyond what we've ever seen before. Let's lift our hands and praise God together. We worship you, Jesus, and we magnify you, and we thank you, God, that you've called us and you've placed us in this world. Oh God, it's such a time as this to be able to be part of the great last day harvest. This is a month of prayer and fasting. We're going to believe and we're going to declare and we're going to request for revival before the throne of grace. And Father, we're expecting, Lord, a harvest because there is a season of harvest, Lord, that we're going to enter into shortly. God bless you today. In Jesus' name, amen.